great British summers. They may not come often, but when they do, people across the nation start shedding not only their clothes, but their inhibitions too.
It's absolutely gorgeous! Sexy! And happy!
That summer was an amazing experience. It was an amazing year.
It's a time to challenge convention, cast out the old and bring in the new. And if summertime is party time, the scorching summer of 1989 was one long party from beginning to end. Young people were turning their backs on the rat race and throwing themselves into a hedonistic rush of new music and new drugs.
Acid House was as big as punk. It was as big a youth explosion as has ever taken place in this country.
We are going to change the world. We're going to make everyone happy people. We're going to make everyone like us.
The atmosphere was amazing. The way everybody came together was amazing. And you just felt like your generation had found its expression.
And all around the world, other people were finding theirs. From pro-democracy movements in China to breaking down borders in Eastern Europe.
I am free!
Britain's homegrown youth revolution sent shivers up the spine of Middle England.
One of the things I remember as Home Secretary, particularly in the early days, was being told that a long heat wave meant trouble.
Let me take you to a place I know you wanna go. It's a good life.
1989 saw the hottest, sunniest and driest May for 300 years.
A lot of dry weather around, a lot of sunshine.
Certainly a very warm afternoon just about everywhere, 28 in places.
Temperatures at least as high as today, if not a degree higher.
It was so hot, the flowers were wilting at the Chelsea Flower Show.
The old hands have never known a year like it. Phew, what a scorcher.
But the warm weather wasn't the only thing to celebrate. Mrs. Thatcher was celebrating her 10th year in power, and thanks to her policies, a lot of people had made a lot of money.
I look back on the summer of 1989, and what I see is a vista of money. There was masses of it, and it all kind of ran around in braces and stripy shirts, and they were yuppies.
What sort of a car have you got?
I've got a BMW.
Being seriously rich is seen as being a very interesting and clever occupation.
It seemed as if Britain in the 80s had embraced a new set of values. The once powerful trade unions had been tamed. Now, survival of the fittest was the order of the day.
We suddenly became individuals, and it no longer mattered what background we came from. If you had it within you and you were ambitious, you could get on and make your life.
By the summer of 89, an entire generation of young people had grown up under Tory rule. Thatcher's children were encouraged to value individual prosperity above all else.
It's more socially acceptable to be selfish, to say, I want money, I want a house, I want a car, to have all these things. It's far more socially acceptable to be greedy.
It was a time when what kind of job you could get, what kind of career you could follow, how you could make money, seemed to be most important. There was pretty widespread feeling of political apathy, perhaps not just amongst the young people, but particularly amongst younger people.
It felt like nothing was ever going to change. We had the Iron Lady in charge, the lady who was not for turning, who was never going to change her mind about anything. We had three general elections in which she won by landslides. And there was a real sense that this is what life is now, just get used to it.
But not everyone had a stake in this economic miracle. And while the rich were getting richer, the poor were worse off. For many, Thatcherism had a hollow ring.
Around that time, we had Mrs. Thatcher saying there's no such thing as society. And it did seem to be that out there in the kind of big, wide political world, it was every man for himself. And there was a kind of breakdown, really, in people taking kind of responsibility for each other, or kind of feeling that we were all in it together. So this is how it feels to be lonely. This is how it feels to be small.
Britain was a very grey, grim place. You know, I mean, now we think of people making lots of money in the city and sort of cocktails, Club Tropicana atmosphere, but that was very much a small elite of people in central London. Elsewhere, there wasn't a lot to do. There were an awful lot of restrictions. You felt boxed in.
But by the summer of 89, young people were beginning to break free of these constraints. A new underground dance scene, Acid House, was turning from a low-level rumble in the capital into a youth movement on a massive national scale.
You'd be out till 9 o'clock in the morning and feeling like you were part of something different. You were part of this secret movement that, you know, overground, the normal man in the street didn't know what he was up to.
The scene was defined by a new look, a new drug, and a new sound, house music. At 120 beats per minute, it was the perfect dance track.
It wasn't hard to dance to Acid House. All you had to do was wave your hands in the air and jump up and down, so suddenly everybody could have a go.
It was the first time I realised white people could actually dance. Do you know what I mean? Because there was this thing that white people couldn't dance.
It had a real trance-like element to it. And I think it was that sort of extra dimension that you got into. You went somewhere else in your head. People did believe that their consciousness was being expanded.
Helping ravers achieve this altered state was a drug which seemed perfectly suited to the new dance culture.
Enjoy this trip. And it is a trip.
Ecstasy was a widely available, easy to pop little white pill.
I think that a lot of different scenes come hand in hand with certain drugs, especially when you're talking about music. And as sad as that may seem, it's just fact. Ecstasy, without a doubt, was the drug of choice, the way that it kind of made people throw away their inhibitions, the loved-upness.
Well, I think one of the key things about ecstasy is it was very difficult to drink alcohol once you'd had a pill because you got dehydrated, so you drank water. So there was no one getting drunk. There was no one getting aggressive. So that was what it wasn't. And what it did do was it gave you a whole sense of openness and of love.
While everybody was on E, everybody was in this hugely empathic state. And if you were at a party with 20,000 people all on the same drug, it was incredible, but you could go to that party and not be on that drug and still feel that feeling.
This sense of togetherness had a particular attraction for young people feeling isolated by the Thatcherite values of the 80s.
I always think that youth cultures in some way go the opposite way from the prevailing cultural mode, political cultural mode. At a time when we're all individualist, and, you know, Thatcher has created the modern Essex man with his mobile phone and his greed, that a sense of unity and community was going to be the obvious antipathy to that, and that came with this incredibly communal drug.
Like youth movements before it, the rave scene came with its own uniform.
It was all about baggy, it was all about fluoro. Really, really bad taste clothes. We're talking the late 80s here.
Dungarees. Oh my God. So unladylike. I don't know what we were thinking, but the baggier the better, the bigger the better, the more freedom the better, I guess. She's got the look.
When you looked out from the stage, you could just see this sea of colour. Purple and green and all these rainbow colours, man. So that was a part of that feeling special. The uniform, you know, was part of the movement, man.
Together with the great music has to be a certain clothing look, a drug, politics of the small p. And certainly, Acid House had that as strongly as punk had had it before.
Challenging the values of society wasn't purely a British phenomenon that summer. All over Eastern Europe, a peaceful revolution was taking place which would have profound global consequences. Millions were rejecting communism and taking their first steps towards democracy.
All the news coming through the door was good news, amazing news. It was the crack-up of the Soviet Empire. it was the what we used to call the satellites in Eastern Europe, shaking themselves free in different countries in different ways. These were amazing things. And we didn't realize, perhaps soon enough, how complete that crumbling away was going to be.
Inspired by the pro-democracy movements in Eastern Europe, hundreds of thousands of Chinese students staged a peaceful sit-in in Tiananmen Square. Remarkably, the Chinese authorities stood by, unsure at first how to respond. As the established world order of half a century was crumbling, at home, another era was coming to an end. The once invincible Mrs. Thatcher seemed to be losing touch with reality.
We have become a grandmother of a grandson called Michael.
If the ground could have swallowed me up when I'd heard she'd said, we are a grandmother, I wish it had. It was very embarrassing.
She had never been more regal. She had never been more presidential. And she swanned around as though the world was at her feet, and in many ways the world was at her feet. But beneath that, she was actually losing grip of the detail of things, losing grip with the direction of Thatcherism.
But even if the Iron Lady's vice-like hold was weakening, the impact of Thatcherism on British culture was total. Profit-seeking private enterprise was king. Record producers Stock, Aitken and Waterman were an embodiment of the economic miracle. Their manufactured, mass-produced music sold millions.
In 1989, the media put us down as the respectable face of Thatcherism. You put one of our songs, the minute it went on Top of the Pops, buh, the next week we were number one. Because we opened it out to that big family audience. And of course, the great thing about 89, which everybody remembers, and we certainly played on it, was fabulous weather. Jason Donovan coming up that hill with his guitar, mate, and the sun was shining, and boom, we did have to be in Australia. You could be in Tipton, it was fantastic.
Blonde-haired heartthrob Jason Donovan was the biggest-selling artist of 1989.
What I did was capture people's hearts and imaginations, and those memories stick with you, you know, for the rest of your life. I know because the records I used to listen to in those days mean so much to me today.
Jason Mania swept the country. During his tour, it was reported that teenage fans were fainting at a rate of one every 12 seconds.
I think the fainting numbers were exaggerated. It made good copy. It made me think, wow, God, I do have an effect. Maybe I should go into religion.
Ooh, welcome. Jason and Kylie back to going live. How can you leave us like that?
Stock, Aitken and Waterman were masters at marketing their records to a teenage audience. Though in Jason and fellow Aussie Kylie Minogue, much of the job was already done.
Neighbours. Everybody needs good neighbours.
By the summer of 89, the unthreatening soap opera world of Ramsey Street was drawing in audiences of 13 million.
G'day. How's it going?
Good day at the workshop. I thought you'd be in the library.
Yeah, we were going to go to the library.
But Scott had a problem.
Because of Neighbours, we were part of a culture rather than just a pop hit. People knew us, or they thought they knew us.
You're a genius, Scott.
Why Kylie was the most phenomenal artist probably for the last 20 years is because girls all associated themselves with her. You know, she was the perfect kid next door. She was, you know, she took the spanner out and fixed the car. And she got this hunk of a boyfriend called Jason. Oh, come on. Can't get a better story than that, can you?
Even stars plucked from obscurity were made to fit the formula with a carefully designed image.
I used to look quite old when I was 17 because I used to have like really long hair right down to my waist. I used to wear a lot of leather. I was kind of like a Rocky type of chick. But of course, Pete didn't want that type of image. You know, he wanted me to look younger. So I was quite devastated when they cut and perm my hair. In fact, I was mortified. And I think that's the way Pete liked it. He liked us all to be nice and clean cut. He wanted the perfect idols that the kids could look up to.